Good morning and welcome to this beautiful Sunday morning, fifth Sunday in Lent. We're winding down our Lenten journey, getting closer to the cross. Next Sunday, boy, you won't want to miss it. It is Palm Sunday. This place is going to be packed with palm branches. Children are singing. They've been rehearsing. We're going to have some piano and hopefully a little guitar and some percussion. Make sure you bring a friend. It's a great Sunday to bring somebody to share the good news. Before we get to announcements, that'll be in a few minutes, but I just wanted to say, in order to help me prepare for Easter Sunday, I want all of you to get out your coloring boxes and color a butterfly. On the back table there in the center, there's three different types of butterflies. You only have to take one. If you can color it in as best as you can, then cut it out as best as you can and bring it even before Easter Sunday, that will be perfect. That's all I'm going to say. And there's no judging, no contest of who's got the best butterfly. You win a pizza or something like that. No, sorry, we don't do that. But anyway, I hope everybody will take home a butterfly, one of the three that are back on the table, and decorate it as pretty as you want and bring it back to church. If you want to bring it already by next Sunday, that'll be great. So when we arrived this morning, we entered into the normal bustle of church on a Sunday morning, friends greeting each other, children bringing their energy and enthusiasm. And now that we're sitting together, I invite you to consider the word sanctuary. A sanctuary is a place set aside for sacred things. It is a place of refuge and protection. This room is a sanctuary. The season of Lent is a kind of sanctuary extended in time. And one of the things that Lent teaches us is that we too are a sanctuary. There is inside of us a place for sacred things, a place where God abides. So as we extinguish our fifth Sunday in Lent light, we acknowledge that many are feeling darkness, pain, isolation, loneliness. Let us pray. Loving God, we open our hearts to you, and we invite you into our inmost being, only to find that you are already there. Strengthen us in our quiet places, in our own personal sanctuary, and then lead us into this world to work for justice and peace and reconciliation. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let us open our hearts as we begin our worship this day.
Good morning. If you could all stand, please, for the call to worship. Come. You who woke early and you who slept late. Whether we are first or last or somewhere in between, there is room for all of us in God's kingdom. Let us worship God together.
Those who are inclined, please join me.
Anybody have any joys or concerns this morning? Nobody? Okay. Then we're going to do the wave. So everybody wave, wave. Okay. And now Mary will do the time for children.
Good morning, everyone. I put my glasses on the top of my head so I remember where they are. First of all, we had a Seder meal this morning down in, with the high school class, and we want to thank them very much because the children really enjoyed it. They learned what they used to have for a meal for the Jewish meal, so it was really nice. So we want to thank them for that. The Last Supper. On the first day of the festival of unleavened bread, the disciples came to Jesus and asked, "Where do you want us to prepare the Passover meal for you?" As you go into the city, he told them, "You will see a certain man. Tell him, 'The teacher says, my time has come, and I will eat the Passover meal with my disciples at your house.'" So the disciples did as Jesus told them and prepared the Passover meal there. As they were eating, Jesus took some bread and blessed it. Then he broke it in pieces and gave it to the disciples, saying, "Take this and eat it, for this is my body." And he took a cup of wine and gave thanks to God for it. He gave it to them and said, "Each of you drink from it, for this is my blood, which confirms the covenant between God and his people. It is poured out to sacrifice to forgive the sins of many. Mark my words, I will not drink wine again until the day I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom." Then they sang a hymn and went out to Mount Olives. Jesus reminders, with your children this week, pick something at home like that looks like a cross or something that is red. And every time that week that you go through that room or you see that color or you see that cross, say to them, Jesus loves us. I just have one other thing. Jesus weeps over the city. Jesus went out to the Mount of Olives with his disciples. He wept over Jerusalem. He said, O Jerusalem, Jerusalem, you murder the prophets and stone the messengers that are sent to you. How often have I longed to gather your children around me like little birds gathering her little ones under her wings, and you would never have it. Then he spoke to the temple buildings. I tell you, every stone will be thrown down, till there is not a single one left standing upon another. Jesus proclaimed the downfall of Jerusalem, which is to murder even God's own son. 35 years later, Jerusalem was destroyed by the Roman army. Thank you.
At this time, we'll just remind you, if you haven't already placed your offering in the offering plates, to do so. This Sunday, we're going to use the doxology. I have missed it, and I'm just being rebellious and saying we're going to use it again. And so, if I could have a couple guys be my ushers and bring the plates forward at the time of the doxology, that would be great. Thank you so much. Now, if you will join me in the prayer of dedication printed in your bulletin, God, and on the screen, God, you are big-hearted with no limitation. You overgive and overpay, handing us not only the rewards due us, but heaping on us the fortunes of everlasting life and love. We thank you that heaven is not just like our earth, that grace does not abide by our rules. We are grateful that our little ways open out when we listen to you. Lavish your spirit of kindness upon us. Help us give and never count the cost. Amen. You may be seated.
Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in his wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace.
Please join me.
Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in his wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace.
It is at this time that we can turn our eyes upon Jesus in this time of prayer. God, like the Israelites in the wilderness, we too have known your love and experienced your care and provision. You call us to extend your love to the world around us, to care for others as deeply as we care for ourselves. And so we bring the needs of our world before you now. In your mercy, let us all respond, hear our prayer, hear our prayer. You claim each of us as your beloved child, and so this morning we repent for how we have fallen short of loving our neighbors as ourselves, in particular, how we have fallen short of caring for and protecting our Asian Americans and Pacific Islanders. We pray for the violent, for those who were involved in the violent murders in Atlanta, Georgia, including the 6 Asian women, and these hate crimes and acts of terror. Holy Spirit, console the grieving families, friends, and their communities whose pain and trauma is too often ignored or cast aside. May we be catalyzed to confront the roots of racism in our midst and even within ourselves. God, show us how our being and well-being are tethered to one another. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for those who do not have what they need in order to survive, those without enough food to eat or shelter to keep them warm, those without employment or enough money to pay their bills, those without access to medical care or medicine to keep them healthy. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for those who have more than enough to meet their needs, but who continue to feel empty inside, who struggle to find meaning and purpose in life, who turn to alcohol, drugs, or other destructive behaviors to try and hide their pain, who entertain thoughts of suicide and choose suicide as the way to end their pain. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for those who are struggling physically, who are battling life-threatening disease or injury, who are living with chronic pain, who are coping with Alzheimer's or facing death, and for all who are providing care for your people. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of the first and the last and all those in between, your grace reaches out to all of us. lifelong believers or newcomers alike. You call us to live as citizens of heaven, to work together with one mind and one purpose, to reach out in love to those in need. Strengthen us so that we might live in a manner worthy of the good news we have received, offering our lives to the building up of your upside-down kingdom, where the last are first, and the first are last, and there is grace enough for all. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And now hear us as together we pray, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Our first scripture lesson this morning comes from Exodus chapter 16, verses 2 through 15. Here, the Israelites are in the wilderness after their escape from starving in Egypt. And while the people have escaped from slavery, they still complain to God about the quality of food they receive and begin to compare life in the wilderness to life in slavery. This is a story where people see the way it was or the way it could have been better than the way they have it. Listen now for God's word to us this morning. The whole congregation of the Israelites complained against Moses and Aaron in the wilderness. The Israelites said to them, "If only we had died by the hand of the Lord in the land of Egypt when we sat by the flesh pots and ate our fill of bread, for you have brought us out into this wilderness to kill this whole assembly with hunger." Then the Lord said to Moses, "I am going to rain bread from heaven for you, and each day the people shall go out and gather enough for that day. In that way, I will test them whether they will follow my instruction or not. On the sixth day, when they prepare what they bring in, it will be twice as much as they gather on other days." So Moses and Aaron said to all the Israelites, "In the evening you shall know that it was the Lord who brought you out of the land of Egypt, and in the morning you shall see the glory of the Lord, because he's heard your complaining against the Lord. For what are we that you complain against us?" And Moses said, "When the Lord gives you meat to eat in the evening and your fill of bread in the morning because the Lord has heard the complaining that you utter against him, what are we? Your complaining is not against us, it's against the Lord." Then Moses said to Aaron, "Say to the whole congregation of the Israelites, draw near to the Lord, for he has heard your complaining." And as Aaron spoke to the whole congregation of the Israelites, they looked toward the wilderness, and the glory of the Lord appeared in the cloud. The Lord spoke to Moses and said, "I have heard the complaining of the Israelites. Say to them, at twilight you shall eat meat, and in the morning you shall have your fill of bread. Then you shall know that I am the Lord your God." In the evening, quails came up and covered the camp, and in the morning there was a layer of dew around the camp. And when the layer of dew lifted, there on the surface of the wilderness was a fine, flaky substance, as fine as frost on the ground. And when the Israelites saw it, they said to one another, "What is it?" For they did not know what it was. And Moses said to them, "It is the bread that the Lord has given you to eat." This is the word of God for the people of God. And let's all say together, thanks be to God. Our second scripture that Kate will be reading is from Matthew 20, verses 1 through 16, and is another of Jesus' parables where he describes to his listeners what the kingdom of heaven will be like. This appeared in the midst of Matthew's apocalyptic discourse shortly before Jesus' arrest and death. As I invite Kate to come now, I want you to listen for God's word to us this morning.
For the kingdom of heaven is like a landowner who went out early in the morning to hire workers for his vineyard. He agreed to pay them 1 denarius for the day, and he sent them into his vineyard. About 9 o'clock in the morning, he went out and he saw others standing in the marketplace doing nothing. He told them, "You also go and work in my vineyard, and I will pay you whatever is right." So they went. He went out again about noon and at about 3 o'clock in the afternoon and did the same thing. About 5 in the afternoon, he went out and he found still others standing around. And he asked them, "Why have you been standing here all day long doing nothing?" "Because no one has hired us," they answered. He said to them, "You also go and work in my vineyard." When the evening came, the owner of the vineyard said to his foreman, "Call the workers and pay them their wages, beginning with the last ones hired and going on to the first ones." The workers were hired about 5 in the afternoon, came and received the denarius. So when those who came who were hired first, they expected to receive more. But each one of them also received a denarius. When they received it, they began to grumble against the landowner. "These who were hired last worked only 1 hour," they said, "and you have made them equal to us. We who have borne the burden of work and the heat of the day. But he answered one of them, "I am not being unfair to you, friend. Didn't you agree to work for 1 denarius? Take your pay and go. I want to give the one who was hired last the same as I gave you. Don't I have the right to do what I want with my own money? Or are you envious because I am generous?" So the last will be first and the first will be last.
This is the word of our living God. Thanks be to God. In the scripture reading, we see these early morning vineyard workers envious of the less hardworking colleagues who receive equal treatment. "It's not fair," they cry out. And to be honest, it isn't. I remember well spending time with my sister and her family when their children were 5 and 8 years old. I spent one half of my time playing with the children and the other half settling disputes about what was fair and what was not fair. Why does Abby get to watch a TV show and I don't? Why does Zach get to drink juice with dinner and I don't? He has more than me. She has it easier than me. It goes on and on and on. Can you relate? Yeah? Somebody? Okay. I'm sure any parents, teachers, aunts, or uncles can find lodged in their memory lots of settling of disputes on fairness among siblings. Well, as we grow older, we whine a bit less than 5 and 8 year olds. And we learn better how to mask these feelings of jealousy, covetousness, or envy. We stop screaming about it to a parent, and we probably throw less temper tantrums about it, but the feeling of jealousy never goes away completely. The questions of why someone has life easier than you do, why someone has more than you do, why someone who hasn't worked as hard deserves the same kind of treatment, why someone who hasn't earned their keep has received what they have, and so on and so forth. Well, let me share with you another story this morning. The story comes from the ancient Jewish tradition and speaks to these feelings that I am talking about. Why do others get more? Why do I work hard and they don't? Why do they have more than I do? And can I even enjoy what I have if they have more? Feelings of envy. Here's the story. There was a farmer in Poland whose family had been poor for generations. And one night, the poor farmer was awakened by an angel who told him that he had found favor in the eyes of God and God wished to bless him. "Make 3 requests," the angel said, "and God will be pleased to answer." There was only one caveat. There's always a catch in stories like this. The farmer's next door neighbor would get a double portion of everything he wished for himself. The farmer woke his wife up to tell her the news. A practical woman, she suggested they give it a try. And so they prayed, "Blessed God, if we could just have a herd of 1,000 cattle, we could break out of this poverty. Amen." No sooner had they prayed these words than they heard the sound of cattle mooing outside their window. Their hut was surrounded by 1,000 magnificent animals. Over the next days, the farmer's feet hardly touched the ground, so overjoyed he was with his blessing. He divided his time between praising God and making practical provision for his newfound affluence. On the third day of his prosperity, he was standing on a hill where he had decided to build, picture it now, a new barn. He looked across the valley at his neighbor's land and saw on that far hillside a herd of 2,000 cattle. For the first time in 3 days, the joy in his heart shriveled, and he went home in a cranky mood and barely slept that night. All he could think of was his neighbor's entirely undeserved blessing and twice the size of his. Deep in the night, he remembered that the angel had promised him 3 wishes. So with that, his old joy came back. He dug deep into himself and inquired what would bring him more joy than anything else. He prayed, "Dear God, if it pleases you, give me a child that I may have descendants to carry on my name. Amen." He was hardly surprised when his wife announced a few months later that she was expecting. And the days that followed were ones of boundless happiness. The farmer was busy enjoying his affluence and looking forward to fatherhood. He was euphoric the night his child was born. The next Sabbath, he went to synagogue and gave thanks to God for the blessing of his newborn child. But he hardly sat down, however, when his next door neighbor rose up to pray, "God has indeed been good," the neighbor prayed. "For this very night I became the father of twins." Our first farmer's mood darkened yet again. The joy he found in his blessings were somehow compromised by his neighbor's double portion. Well, that night his mood waxed even darker. But then he remembered he had one more request. The story says that he then offered his third prayer. God, please make me blind in one eye. Knowing that this would make his neighbor blind in both eyes. No sooner had he spit the bitter words from his mouth than the angel appeared and asked him, why, child, why have you turned blessing into resentment? This request God will not grant because God is full of mercy. Know only this. Not only have you brought sorrow to yourself, but you have brought sorrow to the very heart of God. It's the same feeling the workers in the vineyard had in the text that Kate read for us. The scripture comes in the midst of the apocalyptic discourse in Matthew's gospel, where Jesus begins sharing with the disciples what the kingdom of heaven will look like. And what we come to find out in Jesus' parable is that the kingdom of heaven is not very fair by our standards. Blessings and gifts from God are given in abundance, not in accordance to what is earned. And this is not fair. And it is not the kind of thing that makes sense to us. Why should someone get something they didn't work for, right? Why should I not get more? Why should they get what I worked for? But that way of life, where everything is given according to ability or work, that is not what the kingdom of heaven is like, Jesus tells us. The kingdom of heaven is a place where all are given abundantly, where all receive blessing, where generosity abounds. And yet we humans just can't totally wrap our heads around this. It seems so wrong. One commentator I read describes this scripture perfectly when he remarks, God gives everyone a daily wage so extravagant that no one could ever spend it all. A deluge of grace descends on all. Torrents of blessing fall everywhere. And here, these first hour workers stand, drenched in God's mercy, an ocean of peace running down their faces, clutching their little contracts and whining that they deserve more rain. Envy, the crux of our sermon. Envy and jealousy of our neighbors leads to anxiety and sadness. Comparing ourselves to others is a ruthless task. Wanting after the possessions or lives of others makes us feel sadness and emptiness. It's not where we want to be. It's my presumption that this is how the workers in the vineyard felt too. Feelings of envy bubbled up in them, jealousy at the undeserved blessing the late hour workers received, crying out about what is fair and what is not fair. There is no doubt that is not an enjoyable way to live. So the question that the sermon title says is, are you prepared to die to envy? Maybe better replaced with the question, do we know how to die to envy? It is my suspicion that we all would like to die to envy, to let go of feelings of jealousy, but it's often not just that easy, is it? Envy is this thing that bubbles up inside us from deep inside, some place we've never discovered. They call it the green monster for a reason, a monster that comes from nowhere and attacks us and those around us. So let me ask you this morning, is there a way out of this life? Is there a way to not let these feelings of envy conquer the way we think of those around us, our neighbors, our colleagues, those less fortunate than us, those more fortunate than us, these feelings of jealousy, this need to be better than our neighbors, to have more than our colleagues, this need to have life better than our friends, this need to have worked harder than everyone for what you get, this desire to compare who has what and how they got it? Is there a way to let go of who deserves what? How do we get out of this desperate feeling? Is there a way out? Well, I don't think there's a magic pill or a special switch that I or you can flip, but I do believe there is an answer. I do believe there's a way to live apart from jealousy and envy. I do believe that a different life is possible. To die to envy, we first need to feel gratitude for what others receive, obtain, achieve. You won the lottery, you say? Congratulations, I'm so happy for you. You got a promotion and raise at work? Good for you. I hear your kids bought you a trip to Europe. You are so blessed. I see you got a new car, a new boat, and a new dog. Wow, that is wonderful. By contrast, hanging on to envy means that we mutter under our breaths, why can't I win the lottery? Why not me? Why do others always get the promotion and not me? Why do my kids forget my birthday, let alone surprise me with a trip? Why can't I afford new things, better things? Why am I the one left out? As I said, there's no magic pill or special switch that will make our envy go away. Instead, there's only a decision that we need to make. Will we decide to forgo our competitiveness? Will we decide to stop comparing our situation with others? Will we decide to find joy in the blessings that others receive without thought of our own condition? If so, if we can think of others without thinking of ourselves, then we have died to envy. I promise you that if we first find joy in the blessings of others, then we will find joy in our lives, regardless of our circumstances. We will not need to wish, as did the farmer, that our neighbor becomes blind just so we can feel good about ourselves. We will not need to do as children often do and count Christmas gifts to make sure no one got more than us. Do we really want to live like that? At the control of envy? That's the upside down nature of the good news of Jesus Christ. When we feel gratitude for the blessings of others without thought of ourselves, we have died to envy. And only then can we feel joy as well for the blessings that are in our lives. Amen. May these words be your benediction for this week ahead. Surrender all, die to envy, and live the life abundant that God calls you to live and wants you to live and desires for you to live. God's love and grace is more than enough. Go in peace and feel that peace upon you this week. In Jesus' name, amen. Don't forget to pick up a butterfly. Don't forget to pick up a butterfly. Don't forget to pick up a butterfly. Don't forget to pick up a butterfly.